Hi, good afternoon. So I think, you know, it's a kind of a thing which is being dreamed by any civil service aspirant that they want to become an IAS officer. So like before starting the discussion, I just want to ask what you all know about a civil service examination. Do you know how many services you are aspiring for through this examination?
24.
Okay. So what are the highest service? What do you think?
IRS.
I'm saying the highest service, the highest. IAS. Okay. So this is Indian Administrative Services. What kind of work is, you know, that you need to do when you become IAS officer? What kind of work you need to do, you know, when you become an IAS officer? You know the kind of work?
Policy
making or implementation?
Implementation.
Administrative work. Okay. What else?
Work related to economics, sir.
Work related to economics. Okay. You know, first of all, when it comes to this examination of civil services, the kind of syllabus that has been designed by the UPSC is mainly from, you know, IAS point of view. Like when you become an IAS officer, you know that you're going to, you know, hold so many posts. For example, you will be posted in the Defense Department or in the Finance Department, and moreover in a Science and Technology Department. Then maybe you will become Agricultural Secretary, or, you know, that you will be posted in any kind of area. So the point is that you need to have a knowledge about each and everything. Okay. So that's why in case of civil service examination, the UPSC, you know, is asking these students to read each and everything in a very basic manner. You're not supposed to have the very deep knowledge about anything. It's just that a basic knowledge is being required. Okay? That's why you're having, you know, economic section, polity section, geography section. Like when you become the DM of any district, you need to know the basic aspect of the geographical thing. Like when it comes to providing any kind of, or you can say analyzing any kind of problem faced by any particular area, then unless until you're not knowing something about the geography, climatic condition and the all, then you won't be able to provide proper feedback that what kind of things we need to include or induct in the main policy making of the government of India, you can say the state government. Okay. Now, when you see the other services like IPS, IRS, so these are certain kind of a specific service. Like when you become IRS officer, income tax commissioner, so they will teach you, you know, what kind of things is being there in the income tax sect. Okay, like when it comes to this, like IRS custom and excise, so they will teach you what kind of things is being there when it comes to indirect taxes. Like when it comes to Indian Foreign Services, they will tell you what kind of policies that has been made by the government of India in the early year when it comes to maintaining good relations with the foreign country. Okay, so the only, you can say this entire examination is being designed mainly from IAS point of view. So that's why you need to know basic things. Okay, now when it comes to, you know, the section of economics, like economics is one of the section that is being, I would say, is a kind of a very dynamic area. Under that, first of all, you need to know the basic things about economics. Second thing that you need to know about the current development. So that is the area which requires maximum updation on your part. Okay, so first of all, I'll show you that what kind of syllabus has been given by UPSC for the economics section, how many questions were asked by the UPSC in the last few years paper, and then I'll tell you what kind of source that you can refer. And then we'll discuss in very brief about, you know, what kind of things you need to do and what kind of things you need to avoid when it comes to preparing for this examination. Like, you know, when it comes to the syllabus for economics section in the prelims examination, then you're having three things only. So in case of economics prelims area, the syllabus is not properly defined. Okay, they're only providing you certain basic aspect that these are the things that you need to prepare when it comes to economics section, like basic principles of economy. Under that, you know, you can expect questions from banking, fiscal policy, then you're having things like inflation, then foreign trade, foreign exchange, these kind of things will be asked. So basic principle means whatever things that will govern the basic aspects of economy. Okay, so economy is what? It's basically about the resources that you need to utilize for the purpose of fulfillment of various demands of the people. That is basically economics. Okay, so basic principle means that you're talking about the working of the government in terms of providing various monetary thing. You can say income, expenditure, inflation, foreign trade, these kind of things will be asked by the UPSC in this particular area. So we cannot say that these area you need to stick. So the area is being kind of very vast when it comes to first topic. Now, when it comes to second one, that is social schemes of the government. Under that, they're asking you specifically about the various flagship program initiated by Government of India for the purpose of, you know, poverty alleviation, then you can say unemployment issue, then the various, you know, welfare aspects of the economy. Okay, so like, for example, last year from this particular thing only, UPSC asked around 7 or 8 questions. So this topic is being kind of currently very, very relevant. Okay. Then social development through economic empowerment. Again, you can say it's a kind of a very general thing. So they will ask you a question about poverty, unemployment, you know, various aspects of the economic again. Development means that what kind of things is being done by the Government of India for the purpose of development in the economy. Under that, you can expect question about anything. Like for example, they will ask you a question about the census, they will ask you a question about the population, they will ask you questions about, you know, the international relation also in this case. And specifically in economics, international trade, okay? Now, if you try to analyze, you know, what kind of things is being there in case of this particular area, that is what? The what kind of subtopics we are having. So as you can see here, when it comes to subtopics, we are having topics like population, employment, planning and development, national income, poverty, and the other area. The maximum number of questions that was asked by UPSC in economic section was in 2010. So as you can see here, 36 questions they asked. So imagine out of 100 questions, 36 were only from one portion, that is called economics. And most of the questions were current based. Okay. Now when you see in actual number, then in 2010, 36 questions, then 16, 19, 18, 22, 15, and 29. Last year, 29 questions were asked from the economics section. So on an average, you are getting around 22 questions from the economics portion. So you can expect 1/5 of the paper from one section, that is called economics. Okay, and I'm telling you, questions are being all current based and they're all conceptual based. They're not asking you questions about, you know, the various facts and figures about the economics. They will not ask you like in which particular year this particular scheme was initiated by Government of India. They will only ask you what? The basic concept. So I'll show you the questions also. So you can say economics is one of the portions that will help you in terms of clearing prelims. And moreover, the questions are very easy. Like if you're knowing things, then I won't say that it will take a lot of time to answer these number of questions. Okay, I'll show you the question that is asked by the UPSC in last few years paper. Now when it comes to mains examination, you know, you people are being kind of very lucky that you are having a knowledge about the syllabus of mains examination. Like 4 or 5 years back, when the syllabus for the mains examination was not defined, people were kind of very much confused that what we need to study in the mains examination. But now things are being properly defined. So you know that these are the areas on which I need to focus. And I'm telling you, none of the questions in the mains examination is out of syllabus. All the questions are part of syllabus only. Okay, so your work is being kind of reduced by defining a proper syllabus by the UPSC for the mains examination. Okay, so when you see the syllabus of mains examination for economics section, what you will find that the topics again are kind of very much general in nature. Like for example, you are talking about planning and mobilization of resources by the government. Then after that, growth, development and employment, inclusive growth and issues arising from it, government budgeting. Then you're having agricultural related thing. Then you're having e-technology in the aid of farmers. Okay, so topics are general. You're not supposed to have very specific or technical knowledge about economics. The things are being kind of general in nature. So you're having 3 slides, you know, when it comes to the syllabus of mains, like issues of buffer stocks and food security, technology mission, economics of animal rearing. Then you're having something related to the food processing industry. Then land reforms. Then you're having industrial policy 2 topic, the effect of liberalization. And the second thing is changes in the industrial policy and effects on industrial growth in the economy. So these 2 topics related to the what? To the industrial policy of the Government of India. Then after that, if you see the 3rd slide, then in this case, the topics are, you know, the issues related to poverty and hunger. Then important international institution. Under that, they will ask you your questions about the WTO, IMF, World Bank, you know, United Nations. These kind of things, a question will be asked. Then issues related to direct and indirect subsidies and minimum support price. Then PDS, you can say again part of something related to the agriculture only. Then infrastructure. And the last topic is investment models. Okay, so in total, you are having 19 topics in paper 2 and paper 3 for the economics section. Okay, now when it comes to the weightage of economics in case of your mains, so like in 2013, they asked questions worth of 135, then 130, 150, 150. So on an average, you're having 141 marks. So that means the weightage of economics in case of mains is around 15%, because you're having four papers, 250, 250 each, that means 1,000 marks. And out of this, 140 or you can say 150 marks of questions you will get. So in paper 2 and paper 3, you're having economics questions. Okay. Now, the point is, what kind of material you are supposed to refer when it comes to, you know, covering the economics section? First of all, you know, you are having certain NCERT, and that is all new NCERT. Nothing is like that you need to refer old one, because economics is all current based. So no need to bother about that I need to buy the old NCERT and you need to search in the market. No. All the NCERTs are available free of cost on the NCERT website. I think you must be knowing about this thing. So like, for example, in case of 9th class NCERT, the book name is Social Sciences Economics. And you need to refer only few chapters that is what related to our syllabus. Okay. So chapter number 1, chapter number 2, chapter number 3, and the final chapter, that is about the food security in India. And I'm telling you, the books are being very interesting to read. NCERTs are the book which is being very interesting. Why? Because they are providing you information that is current based, and moreover, they're also providing you certain real examples in the book itself with certain pictures also. So books are interested to read. Okay. Now in the 10th standard, you are having chapter number 1, 2, 3, and 4. And the last chapter called Consumer Right, you need to refer. Then after that, in the 11th NCERT, you are having entire book that you need to refer. Because this book is being kind of very general in nature. It's a kind of a story book only. Okay, don't worry. You know, I'll give you my email address and just send me email. I'll send you the entire slide. Okay, just focus on this thing. Then after that, in the 12th standard NCERT, you are having chapters number 3, 5, and 6. So that is only the macro you need to follow. Do not bother about following the microeconomics, because micro is not a part of our syllabus. Okay, so in this case, the chapter number 3, 5, and 6 are about the monetary policy, fiscal policy, inflation, and then after that, you're having something like what? The foreign trade in the economy. Okay, so these chapters are you need to refer when it comes to the NCERTs. No need to refer the other NCERTs, I'm telling you, because they are not relevant from our examination point of view. Okay? So once you will complete these NCERTs, what you're supposed to do, like if you're preparing yourself and you're not taking any kind of coaching, so I'm telling you first of all from that particular point of view. So in this case, these books are available in the market. Okay? All these four books are mainly, you know, provided by their writers from Delhi University BCom Honors syllabus. Okay, but the point is, whatever topic we are having in our mains examination, they are all are being covered by these books. So you're not supposed to buy all the four. Don't worry. You just need to buy one out of these four, because all the books are having same topics, but the way of classifying, or you can say the way of explaining things, is being kind of different, because you know that different writers are having a different way of providing things. Okay, so you can buy any of these four, but if you'll ask which one is my favorite, then I would say my favorite book is this one, Indian Economy by I.C. Dhingra, because this book is having all the relevant thing, and moreover, this writer is also providing you certain current development in certain, you know, separate chapters. So like, for example, when you study about the land reforms, okay, so they will explain you first of all what is land reform and the related things. Then after that, in the end of the chapter, they're having certain separate extra notes, like they will provide you about the national land reform policy, okay, what kind of things government of India need to adopt when it comes to implementing land reforms. Okay, so this book is being kind of very good if you talk about that, which one I like most. So these four books are mainly, you can say, from prelims as well as mains point of view. That will cover both. Secondly, once you will cover any of these four, do remember you're not supposed to read the complete book, because all these books are more than 1,000 pages. What you need to do, as I provided you, you know, these things, the name of the topics, what you're supposed to do, just mark the chapters in the book and then read only those chapters which is part of our syllabus. Okay? So after completing this, now this book is being helpful for mains examination. Okay? Because in this one, they are providing you complete analysis that what kind of development thing we are having in our economy since independence, that is from 1947 till date. So Uma Kapila, she is a professor in, I think, Miranda House College in Delhi University, and the book is being kind of very good. Because this lady, you know, is trying to compile the various readings by the various good economists in case of India. Like you must have heard about C. Rangarajan, Y.V. Reddy, okay, Bimal Jalan, okay, and certain good other writers. So what she is trying to do, she is having the good articles from the various earlier readings and the current readings, and she is trying to compile all these things in this one particular book. So this book is being very good, but the point is, again, you need to read only those chapters which are part of our syllabus. Fine? Now, if you will do this, an NCRT, what else you need to do to cover the economics? Just read the newspaper. That is all. Make yourself updated with all the recent development and try to, you know, update you. Because whatever question will be asked by the UPSC mains examination, that is all current based when it comes to economics portion. Okay? So that is, I'm telling you from your perspective, that when you're preparing yourself, not by the coaching institute. But in case if you join the coaching, what you're supposed to do, no need to refer any book. Because what I did, I used all these four books plus this Uma Kapila book. I bought all this book. I marked the chapters and I simply, you know, taken those things from these books which are relevant from our examination point of view, and I provide it in my own notes. So I compiled myself, you know, the notes of around 250 to 300 pages from these books, which are relevant from our examination point of view. Second thing, in those 250 or 300 pages of notes, I also use certain Government of India website, for example, Ministry of Finance, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, okay, then Ministry of, you can say, Foreign Affairs, okay, then website of PIB. Then you're having something related to this thing, you know, that the budget, economic surveys of the various years. So I try to, you know, focus on those things which are relevant from an examination point of view, and I simply jot it down in my own notes. Okay, so that you will be able to get when you join the coaching. So what we are providing, you are having one notes from the institute side. Then secondly, whatever notes I will provide you, that is all up to date. Like for example, if today we are discussing banking, and I'm providing you banking notes. So I will provide you one banking handouts from my side. That will be provided to you in soft copy form, okay? That will be uploaded on your student platform. Like when you join the institute, you will have one login ID and password. So whatever class you will do here, like by sitting in this classroom, that is recorded by the person who is standing over here. And then after that, all the classes are available on your platform. So let's suppose, like if you are not being able to, you know, understand certain things in the class, and you're reluctant to ask questions, and maybe so let's suppose that if you're discussing banking today, and after 2 months you're having certain issues to understand banking because you know certain concepts are being kind of little light in your mind. So what you can do, again refer that particular class. So that is a kind of a plus point, I would say, okay, of recorded classes. Then after that, you're having class notes, so what I will discuss, I will provide you in writing also. So certain things I will dictate. And then after that, you're having the institute's notes. So if you're having these three things, first of all, institute notes, again 300 pages, then having certain handouts of mine, and then class notes, I'm telling you, you will be able to cover around 80 to 90% of the economics portion. Nobody can guarantee you about 100% for economics. Why? Because it's a dynamic area. Maybe it is possible that one or two questions will appear, that is out of the discussion we are having in the class. Yes or no? So that is more than enough, I would say, to cover the entire economics thing. Then what kind of question? Like, see, this question was asked by the UPSC last year from economics area. And this question is very, very simple, because as I'm telling you, all the questions are current based and moreover conceptual. Like, for example, recently, which of the following currencies has been proposed to be added in the IMF SDR? So when you discuss about IMF, I'll tell you about the SDR. So last year, this currency was added. Which one? Renminbi. So Renminbi is a Chinese currency. So you must be knowing Chinese currency is what? Yuan. But the official name of Chinese currency is RMB, Renminbi. Like for example, When you see in case of UK, so UK is having a currency name that is what? Pound. But when it comes to measurement of unit, it is what? Sterling. Okay. So you're having things like that. So question is current base, and it's very easy. So as soon as you read the statement of the question, you will simply start searching where is RMB. Okay, you won't bother about analyzing the options. You will simply try to search the option and they will mark it. So it won't take, you know, I would say 20 to 25 seconds to mark this question in your prelims examination. Now, see the second one. Which of the following best describes the term import cover, sometimes seen in the news? So last year, this thing was there in the news. So they asked this particular question that is called, what is import cover? So import cover, if you try to analyze these, you know, option, then I think this is the answer which is correct. It is the number of months of imports that could be paid for by a country's international reserve. So as I'm saying, the things are current based. Like, you know that Reserve Bank of India is providing a thing called foreign exchange reserve. So we try to analyze that if we are having this much amount of reserve, then for how many months it will be able to take care our imports. In case if you're going to have a war with any country, because at the time of war, you know that we're not going to focus anything on the agriculture and the other thing. Our focus is basically on saving our country from the enemies. Okay, so this question was asked. So this term was appeared, so they asked the questions in them. So it will take time, like 1 or 2 minutes it will take to answer this question, because you need to at least study all the four options. Okay, now when you see the third question, why does the government of India promote the use of neem coated urea in agriculture? So like when we discuss about subsidies in your class from mains perspective, that time we need to discuss subsidies like food subsidies, then fertilizer subsidies, then petroleum subsidies. Okay, so that time we'll discuss about that, why the government of India is asking the various companies to coat the urea with a neem oil, because you know that when it comes to using urea, there is a lot of diversion of agricultural fertilizer into the industry. Like for example, in case of Punjab and Haryana, they're using this urea thing for the purpose of making artificial milk. Okay, that has been kind of very, very dangerous to the human health. Okay, so in this case, if you will spray neem oil on this urea thing, then what happened? They won't be able to use in the industry. And moreover, it will also helpful in terms of increasing the agricultural productivity. Okay, so point is, it's not like that if I'm saying something that it is from prelims point of view, the question will come only in prelims. And if I'm saying something is from mains point of view, then the question will appear only in the mains. Point is, they can ask questions in prelims also from a main syllabus. So point is, currently you cannot segregate them. You have to prepare for prelims and mains at one go. In fact, you need to prepare for prelims, mains and interview at just one go. Okay, imagine today's prelims and next year you people will sit in the examination room to provide, you can say, to write your prelims examination. Okay, so point is, think from this perspective, like if you're starting preparation from today, okay, then think from this perspective, next year I will be in the list. Okay, how? That you're having certain time, okay, then you will appear next year for your prelims examination, then after that means an interview, so you can say in 2019, the things will be over for you and you will be part of services. Because I'm telling you, if you think that I need to be complete this examination by 19 only, then you will prepare accordingly. But if you think I'll do this, I'll do that, I'll take care of it, I'll take care of that, then I'm telling you, you will simply waste your time. I'll tell you the story of one of the candidates of classroom, you know, from, you know, I was talking like yesterday. So what kind of things he was telling me about his experience when it comes to, you know, preparation for this examination. So this is a question for prelims 16. Now what kind of mains questions? What were the reasons for the introduction of FRBM Act 2003? Discuss critically its salient features and their effectiveness. So point is, the thing which appeared in 2003, they're asking question in 2014. Why? Because in 2014, Government of India appointed one committee under the chairmanship of Dr. Bimal Jalan to simply provide certain suggestion that how the FRBM target need to be revised. Okay, so question was provided. So everything in economics you can say is current based. So whatever thing is being appearing in the news, you should focus that yes, this is the thing which is a part of our current discussion, so I can expect a question in my mains or prelims examination. Okay, Then examine the impact of liberalization on companies owned by Indians. Are they competing with the MNCs satisfactorily? Like, this question is being very general, I would say. You're not supposed to have any kind of specific knowledge. Like, if I'll ask you to write an essay on this particular thing, then you can write it very easily. But satisfying the examiner with 200 words is being kind of difficult thing. Okay? So point is, writing practice is a kind of must in mains. And third, woman empowerment in India needs gender budgeting. So like last year, there was a lot of discussion about the gender budgeting in case of Indian economy. So they asked question last year of 12 and a half marks. Okay, so the point is, questions are current based in your economics section. Second thing that I want to tell you in case of, you know, this particular examination, that how you can start your preparation. First of all, you know, if I'll tell you, see this thing, that this is your GS syllabus. So I think you all must be knowing what kind of things has been there in your GS syllabus for mains examination in case of paper 1, paper 2, paper 3 and paper 4. Knowing syllabus is being kind of must to prepare properly, because when you study something, if you're having things in your mind regarding your syllabus topic, then you will be able to decide whether I need to read or leave this particular thing. Okay, so what I did in case of this syllabus thing, I divided the main syllabus instead of as per paper wise, as per topic wise. So as you can see in this particular file, I divided syllabus in 13 areas that has been given in your paper 1, paper 2, paper 3 and paper 4. Like, first topic is Indian heritage and culture. Second thing is history of world and society. Third, geography of the world. Then if you see the fourth, constitution. Then fifth, governance and policy. And then you have in the various other topics. Like in case of number 8, you are having economic development. Number 9, science technology. Number 10, biodiversity. 11, security, disaster management. And then you're having in the last, ethics and aptitude, paper number 4. Why I divided syllabus in such a manner? Point is, it will be easier for you to remember the topics. And then it will help you in terms of deciding what to read. Now think from this perspective, like if you people are starting from today your preparation, 13 topics you're having that you need to prepare for the prelims, okay? Plus, you're having one paper of essay that you need to prepare, because I know people are not very good in case, you know, when it comes to writing essay. So they also need to do certain writing practice for essay thing. Then if you're from English medium, then you also need to prepare your Hindi compulsory paper, I'm telling you. Because Hindi compulsory paper is the one in which people are failing. Like almost 1,700 people failed in Hindi paper this year. Because I know you people wrote Hindi, I think, way back in 10th class or 11th class. And from that time, you're not writing any kind of Hindi. So Hindi is the one. Because if you won't pass the language paper, they will not analyze your, or you can say evaluate your GS papers. You will be simply failed. Okay? Then after that, you also need to prepare your one optional subject, two papers you're having. So 13, 14, 15, and then 217. So in total, you need to prepare 17 areas. How many days you are having for the next year prelims? 365 days. How many topics you need to prepare? 17 areas you need to prepare. So imagine you are having around 21 days for one area. That means you're having maximum 3 weeks to prepare one thing. So the point is, time is less and things are very vast. Okay? So in these areas, you're having certain things which requires continuous updation. For example, economics, science and technology, polity, governance, international relations. Okay? So your focus in the newspaper while you're reading it, that these topics are part of my syllabus. So when I'm reading newspaper, I need to know if 7 articles are appearing in Hindu Daily, then out of these 7, how many are relevant from my examination perspective? I'm telling you, maximum 3 in one day are being relevant for your examination, and sometime only 2 and sometime only 1. So that will help you in terms of reducing your time for reading newspaper. I'm sure if anyone out of you is reading Hindu currently, they must be providing 2 hours or even more than that to complete Hindu every day. It will help you in terms of reducing your time and finding the relevant thing. Okay? So what you're supposed to do, send me an email, I'll send you the entire syllabus. It will help you to prepare properly. I'll give you my email address, don't worry. Second thing, what kind of things you need to, you know, adopt and simply leave for this examination. Like, you know, one of our classroom students who scored 15th rank this time, his name is Siddharth Babu. And his first choice for the services was IFS. Okay, so he's surely going to get the IFS for sure. Okay, so I was talking to him and I asked him, you know, in which attempt you cleared this exam? So he said, sir, I cleared in second attempt. So he took coaching from here 2 years back. Okay, so I said, okay, what do you think, what kind of, you know, mistakes you committed in the first attempt? Kehta, sir, I read irrelevant thing. Kehta, I still remember, you know, you were, you know, saying this thing in class, please be focused, you know, whatever is being given in the syllabus. But sir, my perspective was, I was trying to deepen my knowledge in each and everything. Like when it comes to completing constitution, I start, you know, focusing on or start reading something about the discussion that happened in the Constituent Assembly in 1947-48. So I want to broaden my knowledge. So I start reading a lot of things. Kata sir, that was not relevant from an examination perspective. When it comes to reading geography, I start referring multiple books. So I thought, you know, something is being wrong. Because when I was writing my mains, because he wrote also mains in the first attempt, so he said, sir, when I was writing my mains, I was lack of content. In certain questions, I was also, you know, not even knowing whether these things are being part of my syllabus or not, because I was not knowing what kind of things were given in this syllabus thing. So I wasted my first attempt. Kata sir, in the second attempt, what I did, I simply focused only on the syllabus. That these things are part of syllabus, so I need to cover each and everything. So I focused on that thing. And instead of going things irrelevant, I tried to know each and everything in a very basic manner. So I was having knowledge about each and everything. Secondly, I was trying to connect each and everything with the current development. So maine kaha, yaar ek baat batao, was my economics class was kind of useful for your preparation? So what he said, maine kaha, tell me honestly. So he said, kehta, sir, whatever we discuss in the class was actually helped me in terms of reading newspaper properly. Because whatever discussion was having in the class was actually helping me in terms of building my concept for economics. Okay, so if my concept are clear, then it won't be very difficult for me to understand the newspaper. So what I did, I was having my notes, I was having your, you know, printed notes. Then after that, whatever things were appearing in the newspaper, I was simply trying to jot it down with my, you know, class notes itself. So what he was doing, he was providing certain space on both the sides. So whatever development was happening, he was writing over there only. And then after that, second most thing, that writing practice. I did writing practice, I wrote so many answers, I simply get it evaluated from the faculties, from my friends, from my seniors, so that I will be able to know where I am standing currently. So I said, which optional you took? Kehta, sir, I took political science. The second mistake he was saying that I did in the first attempt, that I was not prepared for my optional. Because I was simply focusing on general studies. Because I was giving a lot of time in terms of reading unnecessary thing, so I was not able to provide good amount of time for my optional subject. So the second attempt, I tried to finish my optional even before the December. So I finished everything about political science. Even you can say like by November, or you can say mid of December, I completed my entire thing. Okay. Second thing, why I was able to get only 15th rank? Because, you know, I know when people are being able to clear, they always think that I can score even much better. Okay, so what he said, Kehta, sir, what happened when I gave my first paper for political science? You know, I was not satisfied. So my mood was off. So I skipped my lunch, because in one day you're having two papers, paper one and paper two. So and you're having a gap of around 2 hours, okay, between this. So Kehta, sir, my mood was off. I was like, I can certainly ask, answer the question in a much better manner. So I skipped my lunch and I was kind of very much upset. So when it comes to writing the second paper, I was, you know, not full of energy. And because of that, I was not able to focus completely on second paper. Because of this particular mistake only, that I skipped my lunch, I lost around 20 to 25 marks in my second paper. because paper were easy, but I was not having, I didn't had certain thing, like I skipped my lunch, so I was not able to focus on it. So do not commit such kind of mistake. If you're not being able to do, you know, good, let's suppose in the first paper, then think from this perspective that I need to do much, much more better in the second paper. Take your time, relax yourself, have your lunch, and then go for the paper. Okay? So point is, knowing syllabus is a kind of a must, because I know that other faculties also said the same thing. Because as I was listening to the history thing also, he was saying that you need to focus on the things that has been given in the syllabus. Same thing I'm also saying, that if you're not knowing the syllabus, then you won't be able to prepare accordingly. Do not waste time in terms of, you know, focusing on multiple sources. Just focus on one particular thing. Okay? One particular source, prepare, and then update yourself with the recent newspaper and whatever developments are being happening in the economy. Okay? So whosoever need this particular syllabus, just mail me. Okay? This is my email address, pratik2001@gmail.com. Okay, so I'll mail the syllabus to you. And the second thing is, if you need the slides, like whatever topic is being there in the, because if you're having this, then I don't think there is any kind of need, you know, for this PPT thing. Okay, but if still you want, just send me a mail, I'll send both the things. Okay, so that is in brief, I would say, about the things you need to refer for the economics if you're preparing yourself. And the second thing is that if you're preparing by joining the institute. Okay, now if you're having any question about the economics thing, you can ask. Tell me. Because the remaining thing, that how you need to read newspaper and the other thing, because I know that so many other faculties have already told you. So there is no need to provide or repeating these things again and again. Okay, tell me. Any question you're having about economics, you can ask. Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
There's a lot that I need to cover on my own before I can go into my class and understand it.
Okay.
And after getting all of these resources, mm-hmm. I feel like, should I go to them before I go into my class, or should I prolong my joining of the institute, or should I get into it without any prior preparation?
Ma'am, see, this kind of question, you know, is in the mind of each and every candidate, like when it comes to joining any coaching. So basically, you know, the style of taking different subject is being basically varying from person to person, because faculty to faculty. Like for it comes to preparing my subject, economics, how I cover, I start from very basic. So if you are not reading anything, even before joining coaching, it is not a big issue. But in case of certain other areas, like for example, history, you know, polity, then the other thing, that if you're having certain basic knowledge, I'm not saying you need to have a very deep knowledge, because if you're having deep, there is no need to have a coaching. So if you're knowing basic, only the NCERT if you have referred, then what happened, then when you sit in the class, it will be easier for you to understand things. Okay? So the only benefit I would say, like if you are reading something before, it will help you to understand, and that will simply reduce your efforts when you join the classroom coaching. But if you have not referred anything before joining classroom coaching, then what happened when you join? And when you have something in class, when we discuss something, you know, in the classroom, then what happened? You need to put extra effort to get all these things, because you're not having any kind of prior knowledge. So two things you need to do before joining any coaching, even if you're not reading anything. First of all, sit and read the syllabus properly. That what kind of things is being given in the syllabus of prelims, mains, and interview. Second thing, at least analyze the last 3-4 years paper. So that if you're having knowledge about the syllabus and the proper analysis of questions you're having with you, then you will be able to decide till what level I need to read certain things. Because what happened, like as I was saying, what kind of mistake he committed, he started reading about the debates that happened in the assembly 1947-48. Okay, that was not relevant. So point is, if you analyze the question, so when faculty is discussing in the class, you will be able to figure it out that whether the person is also being discussing the relevant things or not, or it's just that he's passing time in classroom. Okay, so point is, before joining coaching, please read the syllabus, please analyze the question, so that your classroom, you know, joining will be even more fruitful, even if you're not reading anything. That is, these two things are being kind of must. Okay, what else?
So I say, I come from a non-economic background, So is it very difficult for me to get those technical terms that are in economics?
No, it is not difficult. Because what happened, in my class, what I am doing, I'm discussing all the concept, which is relevant. Like what happened in one of my class, you know, last week only, like one of the candidates in the classroom was saying, sir, you're not discussing about difference between GDP, GNP, NDP, you know, NNP and the other things. I said, boss, this is not relevant. Because if you analyze the questions of last few years, then what happened? Only basic things is being asked and moreover, the current development is being asked. So no need to go in the very deep. So when discuss, have faith in your faculty, you know, that he will discuss basic things. And moreover, if you're not aware about basic things, raise questions. Okay? So if you're not good in terms of knowing the technical thing and the other, I'm sure the other candidates are also not very good in terms of economics section. So point is, in economics specifically, what is our focus that we will start from very basic. Then reach to the next level that in terms of discussing thing. And then after that, we'll go to the, you know, next level that is called, you can say, under which you need to have at least basic and some knowledge so that you will be able to understand remaining thing. So it's a kind of a step ladder manner that we will discuss this particular subject. So don't worry, if you're not knowing basics, it will not be a big deal. You will be able to cover everything. Okay?
So why didn't you mention anything regarding the economic survey?
Economic survey, because what happened, you know, when it comes to joining coaching, whatever things is being relevant in the economic survey, I'm simply incorporating in my notes itself. Okay, so I'm not suggesting my students, you know, who are joining classes, that you need to refer economic survey separately because it is a very time consuming process. So only a few things I would say are relevant in the economic survey. So I'm simply incorporating it and discussing in the class itself. Like for example, if today I will discuss something about the banking. So in economic survey, they mentioned about Basel and leverage ratio. So I'll incorporate with my banking class discussion itself. I won't say there is a part of economic survey, okay? Because that was there. So I incorporate it because it is relevant from our examination point of view, okay? But if you think that when it comes to covering economic survey, what is the thing? That we are providing you free classes. I think that, you know, once the economic survey will come, we are having 3 lectures for economic survey that can be attended by anyone. If you're not joining coaching, you can still come and, you know, see this thing. So that will be covered accordingly. Yes, what else? Sir, mail kar dijiyega, bhej dunga, list bhej dunga puri books ki. Second paper to aap class ke discussion se complete kar lenge. Jo first paper ki aapki micro, macro aur jo baki areas hain, theek hai? Bhej dijiyega, mujhe aapko, main aapko book ki list bhej dunga. Mail kar dijiyega mujhe. Theek hai na? All done? Chaliye. All the very best and see you soon. Thank you.